Universal acclaim, box office success, Sundance. How are you feeling?
At the moment or in general?
Just general.
I'm really pleased. I'm proud. It's, you know, you make a film and you hope you put it together in the right way and and these kinds of things happen, that people respond to it. That's really the thing.
Mm. And do you feel like you've got a kind of a sense of opportunity, like you can go and do something else, more personal, whatever you'd like to do now?
Yeah, I mean, I feel like I have a lot of opportunities now that I didn't have. The question is, you know, what do I want to do with that?
Yeah.
So there isn't a kind of a fantasy dream. You know, it wasn't like I always wanted to do whatever, you know, Lord of the Rings for girls or something. I mean, I don't have that on my back burner.
I'd love to see that.
I don't know what it would be.
Obviously, a lot of people have talked to you about casting, but I can't help myself. How did you gather together such a strong group of five individuals that worked so well together?
It wasn't just chance, you know. It was a lot of analysis and kind of mixing and matching, and you know, me sitting in my room and just, you know, sort of obsessing on it, really trying to see it. So it came with a lot of thought. I have to admit, it was a little. People thought I might be going mad at a certain point, but then once I decided to go for Annette, and Julianne was on board with that, and you know, we were talking about who would be the Paul character, and I think I went to both Annette and Julianne and explored a few names with them, and you know, had decided on Mark Ruffalo, but really had their blessing. So I felt like everybody was kind of included. It was an inclusive process, and I think that made them more
like a big family, really.
Yeah, there was a kind of really generous spirit, and you know, for a lot of reasons, and I think that was one of them, that they were included in the casting process.
There's a certain moment, you shot LA in a way for me that it felt almost like a foodie movie, you know, when you see Paul's restaurant. I went, I really want you to make some kind of food movie that kicks Eat, Pray, Love out the water. And is there any chance you could just...
That's so funny, somebody just gave me a script that was like a foodie movie, and I'm like, are you sure people really want to see foodie movies now? Because haven't we seen a bunch of them? I didn't see Eat, Pray, Love, but then there was like Julia and Julie and...
Oh, yeah?
I don't know. There's been a few and they've been kind of...
Okay, all right. Scratch that idea.
Maybe people do. I got to check into this.
That.
I'm going to do some research.
And... Hang on, wait a second. There's a... Paul, I'd call him a broody father character. How did you go about constructing such a... I don't want to say the word unusual, but kind of... let's say unusual character in cinema. I don't think we've seen enough broody fathers.
Broody fathers, what does that mean?
Is that a kind of a you know, masculine man who also wants to be part of a family but doesn't quite know how?
Yeah, you know, that was the last character that we really kind of couldn't crack. And I think for the longest time we weren't going in the direction of making him sympathetic, finding the things in him that were actually really tender and genuinely attractive and not, you know, sort of egocentric and just, you know, kind of rejectable. Mm-hmm. And I think once we kind of gave it equal time and said, well, what's really kind of great and cool and genuinely attractive about this guy? And then paired that up with, you know, some of his sort of more sloppy, narcissistic choices, he became three-dimensional. Mm-hmm. And... you know, as Mark Ruffalo has said, this character really reminded him of guys that he knew when he lived in L.A. that lived on the East Side and, you know, drove motorcycles and thought they were kind of, you know, like to collect old cameras and leather jackets and shit and be cool, you know?